Sunday Night Football returns to NBC with the biggest games, the best team, and on February 1st, Super Bowl 43, only on NBC.
Welcome to Canton, Ohio, and the start of a new football season. Tonight in the Pro Football Hall of Fame game, the Indianapolis Colts meet the Washington Redskins. And now let's meet the Hall of Fame class of 2008. First, Fred Dean, a four-time Pro Bowl selection at defensive end. Fred played with the Chargers and the 49ers and was a force on two Super Bowl championship teams in San Francisco. Emmett Thomas. Emmett played in 181 games as a cornerback for the Kansas City Chiefs in the 60s and 70s and finished his career with a team record 58 interceptions. Andre Tippett. Andre recorded 100 sacks in his 12-year career at outside linebacker for the Patriots and was named to the All-Decade Team of the 1980s. Gary Zimmerman, a seven-time Pro Bowl selection as a member of the Vikings and the Broncos. Gary was named to the All-Decade Team of the 80s and 90s. Darryl Green. No defensive back in the history of the National Football League has played in more games. Darryl spent his entire career with the Redskins and intercepted at least one pass in a record 19 consecutive seasons. And finally, Art Monk. At one time, Art owned NFL records for receptions in a season and career catches as well. Art was a member of three Washington Redskins Super Bowl championship teams. And there they are, ladies and gentlemen, the Pro Football Hall of Fame class of 2008. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, Al Michaels and John Madden, ready to get the season underway. Not a minute too soon, we know, for millions of you. Indianapolis against Washington. John was a part of the class of 2006. What kind of a weekend has it been for you, partner?
I'll tell you, it was the greatest weekend of my life, and I know that these guys here have the same feelings. When you were just introducing them, they're walking across. I remember what those feelings were like, and I just got goosebumps. I mean, it's a weekend, it's a celebration. All the old Hall of Famers come back, and it's a tradition of football, and you have a jacket night, you have a parade night, you have dinners, and you have this, and now you're in the Hall of Fame, and they can never take it away from you. This is big.
Very, very special weekend, and it culminates with a game. Now, we have Indianapolis against Washington. Last year, the Colts were 13-3, were upset in their first playoff game at home against San Diego. And now the big question revolves around Peyton Manning, of all things, who has not missed a game in his entire career, but had his bursa sac removed about 3 weeks ago, is not in camp. Not sure when he'll be in camp. You know, Howie Mandel likes to say deal or no deal. Let me ask you, big deal or small deal?
I think this is a big, big deal, because we're talking about, you know, Peyton Manning, and he is the Indianapolis Colts. And with Peyton Manning, this team can be the best team in the NFL. They can be a Super Bowl team. Without him, obviously, you know, they can't. So I think he's never been injured before, and I think they want to be very cautious. I know that Tony Dungy said we'd like to have him play three quarters in the preseason. I don't even think Peyton Manning needs that. I think the only objective that they ought to have is get him ready and healthy for the season.
And that's September 7th on a Sunday night when they open up their new stadium against the Chicago Bears. Now, the Washington Redskins, Joe Gibbs is gone after 4 years. Moderate success, two playoff appearances, a 30-34 record. Jim Zorn comes out of nowhere, basically. He'd never been a head coach, even a coordinator. He is now the new head coach. They're in a tough division, have a backbreaking early schedule. What do you think of this team's chances?
I think it's going to depend on how Jason Campbell, their quarterback, adjusts and adapts. We're talking to him last night, and his last 8 years of football, 4 years of college, 4 years in the pros, He's had seven different systems. And he says, you know, you just have to adjust and adapt as a quarterback, and you're doing, I understand that, but I also know that you have to be comfortable in a system to make it work. And I think, you know, how quickly Jason Campbell can get comfortable will be a big thing as to how far the Redskins will go.
Speaking of quarterbacks, perhaps you've heard a little bit about Brett Favre recently. More news in the last couple of hours. In fact, Brett Favre is right now on his way in a private plane to Green Bay, Wisconsin. There is a live shot at Austin Straubel Airport. He has been reinstated by Commissioner Roger Goodell. So Brett Favre will be back in Green Bay within the next few minutes. His plane is scheduled to land. Andrea Kramer is our sideline reporter. She'll join us during the regular season, right now preparing for the Olympics in Beijing. So in her stead, the longtime great beat columnist for the Denver Post, Adam Schefter, who has been working with the NFL Network for the past 4 years and has done a yeoman job there, is working with us. So, Adam, we know that Brett's going to land in Green Bay in the next few minutes. And now what's going to happen?
Well, Al, sources close to the situation say that the Packers are now going to have an open competition for the starting quarterback job. And so in this election year, we have now seen the ultimate flip-flop. The team that said Brett Favre would not be allowed to compete for the starting job has changed its mind. It's revised its course of action. Brett Favre will be allowed to compete for the starting quarterback job, which is all he ever wanted. Mike McCarthy plans to address his team after its scrimmage tonight. But right now, Al, let the games and the competition begin.
And this saga is still a long way from being over. But we know what's over, the offseason, because here we go, the beginning of the 2008 preseason. The Indianapolis Colts against the Washington Redskins in the Hall of Fame game from Canton, Ohio. Next.
NBC Sports, home of Super Bowl 43, welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
Temperature in the upper 70s. This is Fawcett Stadium, named after a school administrator here in Northeast Ohio who died more than a half century ago, home to a couple of small college teams and some high school teams in the area, and the Hall of Fame game every August. So Adam Vinatieri ready to kick off. Rock Cartwright and James Thrash are back to run the kickback. Rock is their regular kick returner. We'll see a lot of subs tonight. And we start the preseason with an onside kick, which is recovered at the 46-yard line by Chris Horton, a rookie out of UCLA, drafted in the seventh round. So Horton is able to get possession for Washington and set the Redskins up in good field position right off the bat.
How about Jim Zorn's first play ever? He gets an onside kick to his team, starts to fumble it, and then recovers it. So Jim Zorn now, first time as a head coach in the NFL, first time calling plays in the NFL, now calls his first play.
About two-thirds of the time, an unexpected onside kick last year was successful, but not here. And now Campbell on first down throws to Chris Cooley, and they salute him with the chant of Cooley, who went to the Pro Bowl last year. Jason Campbell dislocated his kneecap in early December last year, and Todd Collins came in to finish the year. Cartwright starts in the backfield. We will not see Clinton Portis tonight. Sellers is the fullback. Moss and Randall L are the regular wideouts, and Cooley the starting tight end. Samuels up front. Kendall and Thomas, the guards, are ex-New York Jets. And Jansen on the right side. And now you've got Rock Cartwright taking the ball inside the 20-yard line to the 18 as he's tackled there by Ed Johnson after a gain of 18.
Yeah, it looked like the Colts were short one guy on defense out there. And you see here the Redskins go two tight ends. And Cartwright is going to run to the left, and they just zone block that thing, and he cuts back to the right. If you look at the guys, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's pretty easy to run when you got 11 on 10.
You would think if there were 10 guys on the field, it would be the rookie coach who would have 10 guys on there. Instead, it's Tony Dungy as Campbell throws to Randall L for the touchdown. So they recover an onside kick, and in three plays, two of which are passes from Campbell, the other a run by Cartwright, in go the Washington Redskins, and a near-perfect beginning for the Jim Zorn era in Washington.
Right, and you see him coming all the way across the field. He was the inside receiver on the two-set side, And remember last year, that was a problem that they had down here in the red zone. As Jason Campbell was saying last night, we were good 20 to 20, and when we got inside the 20, we weren't very good offensively.
Sean Sweezen for the extra point. So Jim Zorn's team needs all of 77 seconds to go up 7-0 in his debut. Some scenes from yesterday's parade, part of the weekend in Canton, Ohio, as all of the guys, the new inductees, the Hall of Famers who've come back, are in a parade through downtown Canton. Big dinner on Friday night. Of course, the ceremony yesterday for the induction and the ball game tonight. Sweezen kicks off. P.J. Rushing, who's the regular run back man, takes it back out to the 20-yard line. So the Indianapolis Colts will take over at that spot. Meanwhile, we cut away to Green Bay and a look at Austin Straubel Airport, the private terminal, and that is a shot of the plane of Brett Favre that's left Mississippi a couple of hours ago pulling up. And in Green Bay, they're five deep along the fence to welcome back number four.
That's Green Bay.
And, of course, Adam Schefter talking about the fact there will be an open competition at quarterbacks beginning tomorrow as Indianapolis in the 19-yard line. Joseph Addai gets taken down by the cornerback, Sean Springs. So with Manning not here, Peyton rehabbing at home in Indianapolis, there's Jim Sorgi, who's backed up Peyton for 4 years but has never started a regular season game. Addai, we'll see some of him. Wayne and Gonzalez outside. Marvin Harrison is not here. Dallas Clark, the tight end. And Robinson, the other tight end. Robinson does the blocking, and they like to split Clark out. Hugo, Federkyle, Saturday, Johnson, and Dean, the interior. A little swing pass sent out to Addai. And then Addai gets past the 20. And Joseph up to the 24-yard line as he hurdles over Fred Smoot and sets up a third down and five.
You know, one of the things we see here, and we know the Colts, and you see it so often with Peyton Manning over the years, this no huddle where they just, everyone just gets up to the line of scrimmage. Quarterback calls the plays at the line of scrimmage. We're going to see the no huddle like this in the first half when the two backup quarterbacks come in. We expect that they will huddle up.
Dominic Rhodes has come back to the Colts, and that's him in the backfield, flanking Sorgi, who takes the snap out of the shotgun and then throws, and the pass is caught up at the 30-yard line by Dallas Clark, and Clark takes it up to the 31. Of course, we've seen so much of Indianapolis through the years with Manning. Clark, much more of a receiver, more of a wideout type than a true tight end.
Right, and he's great right here in the slot. I mean, at doing this, at running patterns, knowing where the sticks are, being able to, you know, get up there, get that first down, but also he is a very, very good blocker from the slot. And with Joseph Addai as your runner, that is important.
From the no huddle, the fake, that buys time, and then over the middle, the pass is caught by Gian Robinson. First-year player out of Missouri Western State. He's hit by Reed Doughty. That's a gain of 17 and a first down near midfield.
See, and Gian Robinson is a tight end there. Now, we talked about Dallas Clark being in the slot, but for Dallas Clark to be able to be in the slot, you have to have a good tight end that if they want to take their coverage to the slot, he can make those kind of plays. The Colts need Gian Robinson to make it this year.
Rhodes in the backfield. Meanwhile, they're looking at Joseph Addai on the Indianapolis sideline from the 47-yard line. That's Anthony Gonzalez making the catch. Gain of four. Sean Springs, the tackle defensively for Washington. A lot of regulars are missing. Alexander could be a good one eventually, number 79 at defensive left tackle. London Fletcher won't play tonight. Matt Sinclair gets the start at middle linebacker, flanked by Campbell and Washington. And we'll check out the secondary in a moment as that pass to Dallas Clark is incomplete.
You know, the point that I was making about Gian Robinson is they lost Ben Utek. And, you know, he was one of those guys you didn't notice much. But because of the things that he did, then they could do all these other exotic things with Dallas Clark. And those are the things that Robinson has to do now are the things that Ben Utek did last year.
Third and five. Sorgi has started the game four of his first five. from the 48-yard line. Out to Clark. And Clark knows exactly where he has to go to pick up the first down and gets there before he's hogtied by Reed Dowdy. So a nice opening drive for Sorgi and the Colts. It's a first down at the Washington 42.
You know, and that's the thing. We were talking to Tom Moore the other day in training camp, and that's the formation that he wants to be in most of the time is with Dallas Clark as a slot. Now, they have the other one where they put Dallas Clark as a tight end and then use three wide receivers. A year ago, they wanted to mix that half and half. This year, he said he would rather much more be in this formation.
From the 42-yard line. Sorgi buys time, but not enough. And that is Rob Jackson staying right with him. Initially, it looked like he'd get away from Jackson. Jackson, a number 7 draft choice, so picked in the last round this year, number 98, rookie out of Kansas State.
And look at who's trying to block him. And we said that that's an important thing, that he has to be able to block. But that's a difficult block. I mean, when you have to pass protect a guy that's going inside and your tackle is going away from you, I don't know that there's many tight ends that wouldn't make that block.
Second and 16 as Rhodes takes it inside the 40 to the 37. You know, a guy like Rob Jackson is looking for a job. You know he's not going to win a starting job. Their defensive ends are Andre Carter, and they picked up Jason Taylor. Neither will play tonight, but those are the guys. And a guy like Jackson looks for a job. As you look at Rhodes, who had been with the Colts and then went to Oakland for a year, and then they got rid of him, and back he came to Indianapolis to back up a die.
As Tony Dungy last night, I said, is this the same Dominic Rhodes that left you 2 years ago? And he said, I don't know. I hope so. We're going to find out in the preseason.
Third and 5. Nice block by him on Washington to buy time for Sorgi, and that's caught by Robinson. So Gian Robinson with another catch, tackled there by Reed Dowdy. And Jim Sorgi, 6 out of 7 for 53 yards on this drive. Joseph Addai, they tell us, suffered a head injury. There he is, was in for a couple of plays. You recall last year on opening night, in the first game of the regular season against New Orleans, he got hurt on the first play. There was a hush over the RCA dome, but it turned out to be a minor injury. He was back before the night was done and went on to a good year.
You know, the old rule when a guy gets a head injury like that early in the game, especially the preseason, the first thing they do is hide his helmet. And I bet you they hit Joe Addai's helmet.
Especially in preseason.
You know, and that play before that, they came on a blitz. Yeah, see, he doesn't have his helmet, does he? But they came on a blitz, and Dominic Rhodes picked it up. And after Sorgi completed the pass, he does have his helmet. They didn't hide his helmet. But Sorgi went over and shook his hand and said, thanks for the block.
Second and 8 to the outside to Clark. And Clark, with a mid-season move, as he's able to spin away from the cornerback on that play. Reed Dowdy now actually came over from his safety spot, and it's a gain of 13.
You notice that all young quarterbacks, when they haven't played a lot or started a lot, they usually work their slots and their backs first. And they don't throw much to their wide receivers. I think these are easier throws. And at some point, I mean, as you know, in this offense, you do have to get the wide receivers involved.
Rose on a stretch play. Spins inside the 10. Taken down at the 8 by Washington and Campbell, the two outside linebackers. So a good drive for the Indianapolis Colts. They started at their own 19. They've had the ball for more than 6 minutes. And this will be play number 14.
You know, we were talking to Jason Taylor last night, and he was talking about, you know, things that he was looking forward to tonight, and he's not playing. But he said, watching Rob Jackson, he said, he looks good in practice, and he's playing his position. He said, I think this kid has a chance to be a good one.
Second and 6. Clark in the slot. Gonzalez split to the right. Wayne to the left. Looking for Wayne. And that is almost intercepted by Fred Smoot. Sorgi's pass behind Wayne, who led the league in receiving yardage, as you look at the recently acquired Taylor. And it's 3rd down and 6.
You know, this is a pattern that you don't see run often down inside the 10-yard line and in the end zone, a hook pattern. That doesn't have much of a chance. That has to be, when you get down in there in the end zone, you have to have a moving pattern. You have to run slants, crosses, outs, corners, those kinds of things. Hooks are darn near impossible to run in that location.
36. And that may have been deflected and is incomplete, intended for Dallas Sparks. So the drive bogs down, and the Colts will settle for a field goal attempt in the game in which the Washington Redskins recovered an onside kick. An onside kick by Indianapolis on the opening kickoff, and then went in for a touchdown in 77 seconds. And now Adam Vinatieri, in his third year after some stellar seasons at New England. In fact, he was so proficient with New England, you know about all the dramatic kicks he's made. Conceivably, he will have a bust here in Canton someday. There's only one pure kicker who's in the Hall of Fame, and that's Jan Senerud. 26-yard attempt is good. So a 16-play Indy drive results in three, and Washington leads 7-3. MetLife navigating the skies above Canton, providing aerial coverage of the action below. MetLife guarantees for the ifs in life. The Redskins will get it as Vinatieri, who just kicked a field goal to make it a 7-3 game and tried an onside kick. Kicks one more conventionally here into the back of the end zone. Washington will take over the 20. All the Hall of Famers, including the two-way man, Bill Dudley, here in Canton. Enjoying the Hall of Fame game on this Sunday night. Well, this is the week. It begins Friday from Beijing. The Olympics, the Summer Olympic Games, exclusive coverage, and a ton of it coming up on NBC. 8-8-0-8 is the date, and it starts at 7:30 Eastern here on NBC, the opening ceremony of the Summer Olympic Games. Here in Canton now from the 20-yard line, the Washington Redskins start their second drive, and this is Rock Cartwright for a gain of 7 behind Sellers. Let's take a look at the Indianapolis defense, such as it is. No Dwight Freeney, still recovering from a foot injury. They have Mathis, Johnson, Dawson, and Brock starting up front. Minus a couple of linebackers. Brackett not here tonight. And Hagler is hurt. Kiaho, Worsley, and Guzman. And in the secondary, no Bob Sanders. You've got Hayden and Jackson outside. Bethea and Giordano are the safeties. Bob Sanders had shoulder surgery. He'll be ready by the middle of the month. They hope to have Feeney into a game in a couple of weeks, a preseason game. As Moss makes the catch up at the 31-yard line with 6:10 to play in the opening quarter. And John, a look at Campbell, who took over as the starter midway through the 06 season and then was doing pretty well last year before he dislocated his kneecap.
Yeah, I like Campbell. I think that, you know, when he can get settled down and know exactly, you know, what they're doing on offense and where everyone is and feel real comfortable with it, I think he has a chance to be a top NFL quarterback.
Great play fake, buys a ton of time, and slings that right on the money in between the 8 and the 9 of Santana Moss, who gets tackled by Jennings up at midfield. A first down, a gain of 16.
Yeah, we see his drop back here, and one of the things that Jim Zorn is working on is this, where he gets deeper. You know, instead of taking shorter steps, he gets longer steps. And then when he gets at the end of his drop, he gets smaller. He kind of sinks down. Then you see the pattern run there in the zone. You just get in the middle of the zone, find a hole. That's exactly what Santana Moss did.
Campbell has started 4 for 4, and this time he cannot escape the rush, and he's taken down. The first guy in was Raheem Brock, and then it was cleaned up by Josh Thomas.
Right, he had Raheem Brock coming from one side, Josh Thomas coming from the other side, and he really didn't have a chance. I mean, you saw, you know, both sides. You see, these guys run so much spin. I mean, they get up, and then they're always going to take that spin to the inside. I mean, you know that Dwight Freeney does it all the time. You know Mathis does it all the time. They take Raheem Brock, put him out there at the end, and he does it just like all the others.
Second and 17 following the sack. Here's Cartwright. Cartwright is the backup back. Of course, Clinton Portis will do all of the heavy lifting. Doesn't figure to play much, if at all, does Portis during the regular season. Liddell Betts is actually the number two guy. Cartwright would be the number three running back and a good special teams performer. He runs back the kickoffs.
You know, it's interesting as we look at the Redskins sideline there. Jim Zorn brought in his offense as really the Seattle pass offense, but he's keeping the Redskin run offense. So the running game that they're doing is Joe Gibbs, you know, Joe Bugel, that type of run offense.
30-15, and soft coverage there. They give Cooley some room to work underneath, and he gets a gain of about 10 on the play, well shy of the first down, tackled there by Kelvin Hayden, and in comes the punting unit. Jim Zorn, he's 55 years old. He looks like he's 45. Of course, if they wind up like 5-11, he'll look like he's 65 by the time it's all said and done.
That happens quickly, but how about on the other side, Tony Dungy, for as long as he's been coaching, he's younger than Jim Zorn.
He is, and he still looks beatific.
Yeah, they both look, what's the word? And he deleted it.
Right. It means he beat you a lot. The kick goes into the end zone. Touchback, we'll take it out to the 20. We'll hear from new Hall of Famer Art Monk when we come back to Canton. Monk last night in this stadium, the last of the inductees to be introduced, and they put it on the clock, and it was 4 minutes and 4 seconds. He waited a long time to get into the Hall of Fame, and they made it memorable for him.
And there's so many Redskin fans here this weekend, and they just loved Art Monk.
Now Quinn Gray becomes the new quarterback as Sorgi plays only that first series, gain of 4. Robinson makes the catch. Speaking of Art Monk, he's down on the field with Adam Schefter. Adam.
Thanks, Al. No Hall of Famer ever had gotten an ovation as long as the one that you got last night, Art. What was going through your mind as the crowd went on with an ovation that seemed like it would never end?
Well, I really didn't know what to do. I was trying to get them to stop a couple times, but they just kept cheering. And but it was just an awesome moment. You know, I don't know what to say. It was just an awesome moment that I know I'll always remember.
How is standing up there different than you imagined it to be?
Just the magnitude of it. You know, obviously I've watched it on TV, and you know, you just kind of get your own impression of what it's like there. But stepping up onto that stage, like I said, when I was up there, and just really seeing all of this is really kind of overwhelming.
When you retired from the game, you led the NFL in receptions, yet you had to wait 8 years to get into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. What was that wait like, and how frustrating was it?
Well, you know, it wasn't frustrating to me. You know, the system is what it is. That's what the process is. It's what everybody has to go through, whether you like it or not. And but, you know, I just went on about my business. You know, I went into the business world and did my thing and just waited for my name. And that's all you can do is wait.
Thanks very much, Art. Congratulations. And Al, before Art Monk wrote his Hall of Fame speech, he consulted with the wives of other Hall of Famers for advice. They told him, when you give your speech, don't forget your wife. He didn't. Right. Al?
No, he didn't. It was beautiful. It was very well received. Crowd loved every minute of it. Classy, classy man. Second down. Art Monk, who at one point, as we mentioned at the open, held the NFL records for receptions in a season and in a career. Quinn Gray, late of Jacksonville, throws, and that pass is caught by Pierre Garçon. Reception by number 85, Garçon out of nearby Mount Union College. Gray last year saw some action in Jacksonville and did fairly well, and then David Garrard came on and won the job outright. And Gray was on the loose before this season began, before training camp started, with the injury to Manning. Bill Polian, the team president, had to go out and pick up some reserve quarterbacks. He had Sorgi, so he picked up Quinn Gray, John, and then he also picked up Jared Lorenzen, the hefty lefty from the New York Giants, who had backed up Peyton's brother Eli.
Right, and I think right now they're thinking of probably carrying three quarterbacks. The last 3 years, the Colts were one of those teams that just had two. They had Peyton Manning, and then of course, Sorgi, they didn't have that third guy. And I think with Peyton Manning getting injured, going into his 11th season, think they're thinking now, maybe we better have that third guy just in case. And it's probably either going to be Quinn Gray or Jared Lorenzo.
Gray throws a wobbler intended for Garcon that is incomplete. And it will be third down and 10. So there is Sorgi, who figured to play maybe a couple of series, but that first series was so long and he was very effective, 7 out of 10 for 66 yards. And there's Tom Moore in front of him. Maybe the Colts just figuring right now, okay, we have 5 preseason games. That's enough for Sorgi tonight.
I play Sorgi more. I mean, I think, you know, it's been so long since he played. And, you know, to give him a chance to start a game, get a feeling, and get it going, I don't know why you have to take it easy on Sorgi. I mean, he can't be tired.
I would think part of it has to do with they're playing this extra preseason game. Now you've got Gray, and Gray will escape and pick up the first down. And maybe it has to do with the fact that they don't figure to have Manning at all in preseason, maybe at the very, very end. So Sorgi will see a lot of action down the line here.
No, and that's exactly what it is. And, you know, but you still go, you know, why do you have to take a guy that never plays and he finally gets a chance and rest him? But as you say, they still have 4 more. And I don't know that Peyton has to play. I don't know. You know, Tony Dungy says we'd like to have him play 3 quarters in the preseason, and that would be an ideal situation. But if that doesn't happen, that's not all bad if he's ready when the season starts.
Gray throws to the outside here, and that's Aroma should do. Devin Aroma should do, who saw some action making the catch. Speaking of wideouts, Marvin Harrison, who missed a good part of last season with a knee injury and had surgery on his other knee in the offseason, is back in camp, but is not here tonight. They're resting him and hope to have him back probably in a couple of weeks. That's the end of the first quarter. Quickly played. Washington 7, Indianapolis 3, and Sunday Night Football resumes after these messages. Al Michaels, John Madden, and Adam Schefter back in Canton, Ohio. Peyton Manning, just the update there, on the 14th of July, they removed a bursa sac from his left knee. It was infected, that's cleared, swelling decreasing, and Tony Dungy was telling us the other day that the target date, if there is one, for Peyton to play would be August 24th. That would be the next to last preseason game, their regular season opener on a Sunday night on NBC against Chicago and opening up their new stadium, Lucas Oil Field. Here's Clifton Dawson for a gain of a couple through the middle. Bill Polian, the president of the team, who's done such a masterful job with this organization, which is the creme de la creme, along with New England, of the NFL over the past few years, and has drafted so brilliantly, talking about Manning and hoping that Peyton can get back to camp. They train in Terre Haute, which is about an hour and a half from Indianapolis to the west. But they want to keep him away. They kept him away. They didn't want the bursa sac to get reinfected, or that area to get reinfected, and just felt it was better to keep him back in Indianapolis. But they think they might get him back to Terre Haute in the middle of the week.
Well, I think they had him in Terre Haute for a couple days. Supposedly, I was there on Wednesday, and they said that he was there in town, but he wasn't anywhere to be seen. And, you know, but they said he was there, but then he went back to Indianapolis. And there's no need for him to be here in the sideline, and there's really no need for him right now to be in training camp.
I've been to Terre Haute. How do you hide somebody in Terre Haute?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I ask that same question. You know, how can we not see him? How can we not? It's Peyton Manning. And I know one thing. He wasn't in the cafeteria, and he wasn't on the field.
4 to 4 seasons. On third down and 3, that pass out in the flat is caught by Anthony Gonzalez, but he is pushed back, and let's see where they spot the forward progress. That's going to be a little short of the mark, so it's going to be 4th down and 1.
Yeah, see, now this is the other place, the other thing that they use when they use a wide receiver in the slot, and that's what Anthony Gonzalez is doing right here. We showed earlier when Dallas Clark was in the game, he would play that position. If Dallas Clark had run that same pattern from that slot, I'll guarantee that would have been a first down.
They'll go for it on 4th down and 1 with Gray at the helm, and he's going to throw on 4th down off his back foot, and the pass is incomplete. Carry Campbell put the pressure on. The pass was intended on the outside for Aroma Shadu. They turn it over on downs, and the Redskins have the ball. Season season gets underway Thursday night, September 4th. That's a month from tomorrow. Special 7 o'clock Eastern time start, Washington at the Giants. And then on that Sunday night, it will be the Bears at Indianapolis. Coverage beginning with Football Night in America. Before the games on Sunday night, Bob Pastis and the gang will all be on hand again this season. First down and 10 now, as Todd Collins comes into the game for the Redskins, taking over for Campbell, and he hands the ball off to Rock Cartwright up to the 30-yard line. So, John, the numbers for Campbell, 5 out of 5 for 61 yards, one touchdown, no interception, and Jim Zorn has to be pretty pleased with that opening salvo.
Right, and I think that Jason Campbell has to be pleased with that. I mean, that was one of the... You know, that was one of the things that he wanted to do, you know, is just get a rhythm going, get something going, you know, and kind of keep it going, go down and score and do all those things. And 5 for 5, that's pretty doggone good.
Now Collins throws, and that's caught. Might be a first down. Todd Yoder, one of the tight ends, with the head linesman, comes in and appears to spot it just a little shy of the yellow line. Tackled by Condren. As you look at Campbell, Collins was a tremendous feel-good story at the end of last year. Hadn't started the game in 10 years, and he comes in and fills in for Collins and helps lead them to a win against Chicago, and then wins the next three games against the New York Giants, against the Minnesota Vikings, and against the Dallas Cowboys to get them into the playoffs. Off the fake. Collins caught by Yoder, and Yoder takes the ball up to about the 42-yard line.
You know, as we look back at Jason Campbell and the objectives and things that they wanted to do is he wanted to, you know, explode from center. You can see him do that, throw in rhythm, get back there, get the ball out of there quickly, don't hold it for a long time. And all those things that Jim Zorn had been teaching him, talking about, that Jason Campbell had been absorbing, you can see work in that period there.
Second down and one, and it was movement out of the backfield. Looked like the fullback jumped. Walt Coleman is the referee, and it's the first time we've heard from Walt tonight.
16, offense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Billy McMullen.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive about this game, though. I mean, here we are, really, this is the bonus week. This is before the first week of preseason, and these guys played this first part of football pretty good.
And we've done enough of these games to know it can be a flag fest.
And it can be very sloppy in play. Guys missing assignments and, you know, and sacks and all those kinds of things. But that hasn't been true so far.
On second down and 6. Cartwright up to the 39-yard line.
You know, one of the guys on defense that the Colts really liked is another free agent, Eric Foster. He's number 68 there, and in practice that's all they would talk about. He's a rookie free agent from Rutgers, and he's caught the eye of everyone. I mean, not only the coaches and Bill Polian, but all the players talk about this guy and say, boy, I like him. I mean, you know, here's a free agent. No one drafted him, and he has a chance. He had a chance to jump offside.
But he got back onside as Collins looks around, and before he goes down, the pass is incomplete. They've had some luck with free agents out of Rutgers. Gary Brackett, who's the starting middle linebacker, was a free agent out of Rutgers.
So they've had pretty good success there. Yeah, as we watch Foster on this play, you'll see that it doesn't take him long when you go to the Colts to learn that spin. I mean, here he is, boom, he's spinning right there, but he spun himself right into a double team. I mean, once you come out of that spin, you can't be going sideways. You have to get into the spin, and then when you come out, you have to be going up the field.
Sweeney will get a hold of him and work with him. Durant Brooks with a kick, and that will be downed at the 7-yard line. So the Colts are pinned deep. Emmett Thomas is one of the new Hall of Famers, and the great former Kansas City Chief cornerback will be coming into the booth to visit with us when we come back to Canton, Ohio on Sunday Night Football. Emmett Thomas, one of the new Hall of Famers, inducted here yesterday, played with the Kansas City Chiefs from 1966 through 1978, spent his entire career with the Kansas City Chiefs under Hank Stram. now has a Hall of Fame ring to go with a Super Bowl ring from the Kansas City days, and was an assistant coach under Joe Gibbs for a couple of Super Bowls that the Washington Redskins won. Emmett is in the booth. We'll get to him in a second as Indianapolis takes over with Quinn Gray on first down, handing the ball off to Clifton Dawson. Emmett, congratulations. From a little school in Texas to the Hall of Fame, what's it like for you?
Since learning that I have became a member of the most, you know, this fraternity, my emotions have been off the chart. I mean, you can't explain it to anyone unless they get in or be here to experience it. They tried to prepare us for it when we went to Hawaii, but it didn't do it any credit.
No, they can't, because you've never had anything like this. I mean, this is something that, you know, you've waited for a long time, and I know as having, you know, coached against you for so many years. You know, we used to play, you know, two, three, sometimes four times a year. So if there's anyone that knows Emmett Thomas as a player, I do. And you were one of the greatest that ever played. You were darn near impossible for us to get a pass pattern against, and you're a true Hall of Famer.
John, before Emmett can answer, you, of course, you know, it's like, this is like playing the Franco Harris play for John, because this cost you an opportunity to get to a Super Bowl. There was Emmett Thomas in the AFC Championship against Oakland, and that led to you.
What? No, you're the greatest. I mean, you're. There was no tougher corner to play against in this league when I coached in Emmett Thomas.
I appreciate that.
And there's a snap that will go out of the end zone for a safety. And of course, that led to Kansas City against Minnesota in the year before the two leagues merged, and you wound up with a Super Bowl ring in Super Bowl IV.
We were very fortunate to get into the Jets and beat them, and then come into the Raiders Coliseum and beat them, because I'll tell anyone right now, I'm a proud Chief, but the Raiders was an excellent football team. If we played them 10 times, they'd probably beat us 6-7, but we were fortunate enough that day to win that one.
From Bishop College to the Hall of Fame. Emmett Thomas, congratulations.
That's a classy guy.
Thank you, Cody.
Welcome to the club.
Thank you.
Well, the safety as Jamie Richards snapped the ball into the end zone. It is 9-3 Washington. Jamie Richards, seventh round draft choice out of Buffalo, snapped the ball out of the end zone. And now the free kick here is fielded at the 7-yard line. Free kick by Hunter Smith. Taken by Byron Westbrook, who is the brother of the Philadelphia Eagles' Brian Westbrook. As we go back and take a look at the bad snap, it winds up costing the Colts 2 points.
One rule as a center, you always tell yourself, don't snap it at 12 o'clock. Jamie Richards snapped it at 12 o'clock.
High noon.
Usually when a guy does that, and I've been watching him, he hasn't done it yet, they usually go over and start. Well, there he is right now. Usually that happens. They go right over, pick up a ball, start practicing snapping right there.
On first down, Marcus Mason. You have to feel for a guy. I mean, the guy, he goes to Buffalo, University of Buffalo, gets drafted in the seventh round. And his NFL debut is a bad snap out of the end zone for a safety on national television.
No, you don't want that. I mean, you always think of that, get the snap back there. And then, especially if you have a nose tackle over you or a cock nose tackle where you have to reach him, you know, where you have to snap it, then reach out, that's the toughest block the center has to make.
And second and seven, the pass is incomplete, intended for Billy McMullen, fifth-year player out of Virginia, and we have a flag. Walt Coleman throwing the marker for the second time tonight.
Still Silva on the coverage for the Colts.
Personal foul. Chalk block. 69. Offense. 15-yard penalty. Still second down.
So the chop block is called on Jason Fabini, who came over from the Jets.
Here's Jason Fabini right there. Oh, yeah, you see what happens is he gets the chop block when there's an engagement here. See, I mean, he could come. That block would be legal there if there wasn't contact up above. But the contact up above and then chopping. is your leader.
Takes two guys to form a chop block. And this is Marcus Mason, first-year player out of nearby Youngstown State, tackled by Kyle Shotwell.
I got one for you. Bill Dudley, we showed him earlier. They introduced him at the luncheon the other day. Now, I'm not a facts guy or a stats guy or anything like that, but they said that in one game, he scored nine different ways.
And you were in the car on the way back trying to figure out nine different ways.
I was on the bus with him on the way back with him trying to figure out the nine ways. And we figured out the ninth I came up with as a safety.
Third and 18. Collins gets taken down. You make that a trivia question. So Todd Collins gets taken down in the grasp of the rookie Marcus Howard. John talking about him earlier, fifth-round draft choice out of the University of Georgia.
He's only 6 foot, 237 pounds, but he has great speed. You know, and they have Freeney and Mathis, and they like that kind of guy, and they think Howard could be that guy. You know, that speed rusher off the edge, the Colts defense is always going to have those guys.
Logo, logo!
Here's Durant Brooks sending it skyward. Pulled in by T.J. Rushing at the 37-yard line. Coming to the outside. Turning the corner and staying in bounds. There's a flag that gets thrown. And Rushing is going to go down the sideline for the moment for a touchdown. But a penalty marker back up near midfield on what would have been a 63-yard return.
You know, and that was a perfect wall that the Colts formed over here. You know, you have a middle punt return, a right or a left. That was a left punt return with a great wall, although it's probably going to be called back.
Holding, 26 of the return team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And that's Kelvin Hayden, one of the starting cornerbacks playing on special teams. So about halfway through the second quarter, Canton, Ohio. Redskins 9, Colts 3 in the Hall of Fame game. Inside the hall, which gets bigger and better every year, right off I-77 here in Canton, Ohio, about an hour and 15-minute drive south of Cleveland and about a half hour south of Akron. Quinn Gray, the quarterback, from the 44-yard line, hands the ball off to Kent Keith. He gets to the 42. Now, if you missed it earlier, Brett Favre arrived in Green Bay within the last hour, gets off the plane with his wife, Deanna. He'll be getting into a truck. He heard the crowd, which had lined up about five deep along that chain link fence at the FBO there in Green Bay, with the chant, "We want Brett, we want Brett." Well, they've got him.
Well, and I think they're going to get him, too. You know, because they say it's going to be an open competition. Well, that's the way it always should be. I mean, that's pro football. It's always an open competition.
This is Pierre Garçon making the catch. And that'll be a first down. Garçon trying to win a job among a very deep and efficient and outstanding receiver core.
But I bet Pierre Garçon wins a job here because, again, you know, you talk about guys that coaches like. And Tony Dungy told us that this guy has been the biggest surprise in their training camp thus far. And he's also a punt returner. You know, so the more things you can do, the better your opportunities to make a team.
Now Gray, the former Jaguar, launches one for the end zone and connects with Jones for the touchdown. Andre Jones, first-year player out of Hampton, on the receiving end for Tony Dungy, and Indianapolis has tied the game with the extra point to come.
Yeah, we just see it again. Anytime a quarterback can move and buy a little more time, his chances of finding a wide-open guy are pretty good. You see Quinn Gray, he goes, he drops back. He sees a push up the middle. He gets to the outside. Watch, there's no containment out there. So he just gets his outside receiver who's just running straight up the field in Andre Jones.
So you have Pierre and Henri, except Henri spells his name O-N-R-E-A. Well, I should call it the French connection.
Yeah, but that one was all about Quinn Gray. You have Quinn Gray getting out of the pocket, buying time, made that play.
30-yard touchdown, extra point, good. Colts take the lead by one.
What can I say about my mom? Thank you for teaching me perseverance. Life wasn't easy for us moving from Birmingham, Alabama to Newark, New Jersey with not much more than the clothes on our back. Through my mother, I learned to be accountable for my actions and understand the consequences of those actions.
For the Redskins. Andre Tippett. Well, Adam will be visiting with him shortly, right after the kickoff here, as Adam Vinatieri sends it down a yard into the end zone. Justin Tryon will run it back, and the coverage is good. Taken down at the 19, so Andre Tippett is down on the field. Let's go to Adam.
Thanks, Al. Andre, before you came to Canton, the Patriots asked you to address their team. What was the message that you gave to Tom Brady, Randy Moss, and the rest of the New England Patriots?
Well, I think that everyone needs to know their history. And it wasn't so much as Tom and those guys. I think it's more of the rookies that are coming in, the new rookies that are coming in. We really want those guys to respect and understand the league and know the guys. If you're playing a wide receiver position, know who Lynn Swan is, Charlie Taylor. Know what those guys did to get to where they are, and look at their body of work. And you have something as a measuring stick. And I think we wanted guys to appreciate what this league is all about. There are a lot of people that have went to a lot of great work to make this league what it is today. I respect the league. I respect the league before I got here, and I continue to respect the league as I'm out of it. And regardless of the fact of what's taking place with the Hall of Fame and everything, I've always respected the men who played this game.
Thanks very much, Andre. And Al, Bill Belichick recently called Andre Tippett every bit as dominating a player as Lawrence Taylor.
Well, it was interesting yesterday, as after Mason gains one, he then picks up a first down. Bob Kraft did the induction speech for him yesterday, and just in glowing terms talked about what he meant and how important he was in the formative years when Bob owned the team and actually was a fan of the team, and Andre Tippett was making his mark that eventually led to Canton, Ohio.
Right, and he was one of those guys, you know, that was that pass-rushing linebacker type of guy. He and Lawrence Taylor, those were the best, and they're the ones that, if you're playing that three-man line, you still watch film of those guys.
Collins hitting Fred Davis, the second-round draft choice out of USC, as we go back to take a look at Andre Tippett during his playing career in the 80s and early 90s with the New England Patriots, and helped guide the team to its first ever Super Bowl appearance against the Chicago Bears following the 1985 season.
You know, they learned quickly about Andre Tippett is you can't block him with a running back or a tight end. You have to get an offensive lineman on him, just like you did Lawrence Taylor.
Same number as Taylor. This is the first down here as Mason takes the ball for a first down. So Jim Zorn making his debut tonight as the Redskin coach. It was a shock to everybody when Zorn was named the coach. He was actually hired by Dan Snyder, the owner, and Vinny Serrato, who runs the football end of the Redskin operation, as the offensive coordinator. So he's already in staff meetings. They don't have a head coach, and he gets a call one night to go to Mr. Snyder's house to be interviewed for the head coaching job. Todd Yoder takes it to the 47. So Joe Gibbs retires. There is Dan Snyder. Serrato sitting next to Dan Snyder. And they looked at a lot of people. They looked at Jim Fossil, who thought at one point he might be the guy to get the job. They also interviewed Ron Meeks, who's the defensive coordinator of the Indianapolis Colts, and others along the way, and wound up hiring Jim Zorn after they hired him as the offensive coordinator.
Right, and he was shocked. I mean, he called him over to Daniel Snyder, did to his house, and he was working. He just had on a T-shirt and a pair of pants, and he told him, no, we want to interview now for the head coach, so go back, get some clothes on, and then come back for a formal interview.
Well, his family is still back in Seattle at that point, and he's having meetings. And all of a sudden, you know, he's trying to get an apartment and get set and get the family on their way to D.C. And then Snyder's interviewing for the head coaching job. I said, so what did you tell your wife? He said, well, I called her after that first interview. I said, what was her reaction? He said she was aghast.
What she got?
First and 10. Here's Mason again.
But I think it's Mason here. Again, I think it's interesting what he did, though, is keeping Joe Bugle as the offensive line coach, letting Joe Bugle install the running game, keeping the running game the same. So, you know, as I said earlier, we're talking about Redskin run game, Seattle pass game. There's Joe Bugle.
And we've come to the two-minute warning. Colts 10, Redskins 9. Coming up, the Toyota Halftime Show. Bob Costas, Chris Collinsworth are in Beijing, and we'll hear from them live where it's already tomorrow morning. And, of course, the opening ceremony of the Summer Olympic Games taking place on Friday right here on NBC. It's going to be a very exciting 2.5 weeks. From the 29-yard line, following the two-minute warning, Rock Cartwright starts by picking up a first down, taking it to the 24-yard line where he's tackled by Darrell Reed.
You know, one of the guys the Redskins like in that offensive line is Chad Reinhart. He was a third-round draft choice, and he can play either guard or tackle. He's number 75 right there, and he's a good-looking prospect. I mean, he's a good blocker, good pass protector. They think they're following him up a little, you know, playing him both right now as he's learning guard and tackle, but he's going to be a good one for a long time.
Went to Kurt Warner School, Northern Iowa. Here's Cartwright. And Cartwright gets forced down at the 24. We saw that strip come across that said coaches' challenge is no longer allowed. It startled me for a second. I went, what do you mean? And then I realized, well, we're inside 2 minutes. It means it's not allowed for the rest of the half. Just to clear that up.
Made up a rule.
I mean, I looked at this and I'm going, what am I missing here?
No, but I mean, this has been a pretty good half of a first game preseason football. Again, Tony Dungy and his organization, you kind of expect it. Jim Zorn knew, you know, you don't expect it that much. Very impressive.
Jim Zorn takes a timeout to chat with Collins, and we can tell you that Sunday Night Football from Canton, Ohio is being brought to you by Frost Brewed Coors Light, the world's most refreshing beer, and by Turbo HD by Dish Network. That was Friday night. They had the gold jacket ceremony. Huge dinner here in Canton, Ohio. Thousands of people in attendance at the convention center every year, and it's really a special night, and as John talked about at the opening of the show, a magnificent weekend.
You're right, and that's one of the underrated things is that Friday night dinner when you get your jacket. Well, I'm talking about goosebumps all the time. I always have goosebumps, but that was one of those things when you... All the other Hall of Famers are there, and they all come up and greet you, and they give you that jacket. Ooh, that's just a wow.
We just saw Jason Taylor. Collins on second and four. In trouble. Loses the ball. Looks like he tried to underhand it.
Yeah, who's the referee here?
Yeah, it's Walt Coleman of Tuck Rule fame. Jeff Charleston is the guy who punched the ball out. And we'll see who is at the bottom of the pile. Almost looked like an illegal forward or... forward pass that was to an ineligible receiver, but there's no flag on the field, even though Coleman will take a look right now and make the ruling.
Got a fumble forward, recovered by a different player. We'll put the ball back to the spot of the fumble. Third down.
Recovered by Jason Fabini. Take a look here.
Here Charleston's coming from the outside. Pushes him, he just gets it right there. That was close to a
sort
tuck,
of a
wasn't
tuck.
It?
Yeah,
it was a sort of a tuck.
Underhanded
but
tuck.
Walt Coleman, who called the original tuck, didn't call this one a tuck.
Right, in the Oakland New England game. And
he said this is a fumble.
Well, what they're going to do now is, well, there are no coaches' challenges, but the replay booth upstairs can assess it. And so Coleman will go over and talk about it. And we can tell you that you saw Jason Taylor before, who got traded from Miami to Washington when Philip Daniels was hurt in the opening practice. And he had that little note that said, truly blessed. Here again is a look at what Coleman is looking at. That may be a fumble.
Yeah, but it would have been a tuck, but they had his arm, so he couldn't tuck.
Right.
He just had to kind of flip it down. I don't know. It looked like his hand, you know, tried to do that with it.
Well, they're ruling it a fumble.
But the big thing is Fabini recovered it anyway? So I mean, we would have a story here if this happened and the Colts recovered it. But Collins' own offensive lineman recovers the ball.
I thought Coleman said it was a fumble, which I'm confused by. If he said it was a forward pass, I could see why they'd review it. But if it's a fumble, I'm not sure what they're reviewing here.
Right. He said it was a fumble.
Yeah. Maybe he meant to say it was a forward pass. Actually, what they can do upstairs is they can actually change it to a forward pass and incomplete. So you know what, you're splitting hairs here. The end result is going to be Washington has the ball within about a yard of where it would have been anyway.
Third down.
Have you ever heard of the team over officiating?
Yeah, that's it right there.
Yeah, this is it.
I mean, either way, no matter what was going to happen, Washington was going to get the ball, and they were going to get the ball at either the 27-yard line or the 27.5-yard line. But we had nothing else to do anyway, so what the heck?
It was just a waste of time.
Right.
First team timeout, Indianapolis.
Indy takes the timeout. Back to Jason Taylor for 1 second as you took a look at him. In Miami, of course, that's where he spent his whole career, and there was a lot of talk in the offseason with Bill Parcells coming down there to run the team, that, you know, Parcells was not going to want Taylor because he to come to play with the Dolphins this season, because he wasn't going to the organized team activities during the offseason. He had other fish to fry, namely he was a contestant and a pretty good one on Dancing with the Stars.
A very good one on Dancing with the Stars, and I was surprised that Miami wanted to trade him or Bill Parcells or whomever, because this guy is a guy that's a good guy, and he's an excellent player, and he works hard, does everything that a coach or an organization would want. So I would think coming in new that you would want a Jason Taylor. Now, I know you only have him another year or two, but I mean, he's the kind of guy I would want on my team.
Third and 12, on a draw. Cartwright takes the ball to the 22-yard line, and that'll make it fourth down and 6 with a half minute to go. 33 ticks officially.
I shouldn't admit watching Dance with the Stars, but I was telling him, as I watched him, it looked like he lost weight. And I said, you know, he was a big guy at the first, they said, and then at the end, I thought he lost 20 pounds. He said he didn't. He only lost 3 pounds, but he lost how many body fat things? I mean, he went down, his body fat was 6.
He said he went from 8.5% body fat to 5% body fat.
To 5%?
Right.
I mean, you can see, I mean, there's not... I mean that looks like non-body fat to me.
But
that's what he said he did in Dancing with the Stars. Like, if you want to lower your body fat, dance.
We put on 5% body fat last night at dinner. Yeah. That's insane. I've never heard of anything like that.
I went to a different restaurant. I put on more than that.
Sean Sweezum for a 39-yard field goal attempt to try to reclaim the lead for the Washington Redskins. And that kick is no good. Outside the right upright for 29 seconds. So Sean Sweezum can't knock it through. Indy still has the lead. And we can remind you that MetLife is providing the aerial coverage tonight as you look down into Fawcett Stadium here in Canton, Ohio. MetLife celebrating 140 years in business. Look at all those hash marks. We mentioned before, this is a stadium that is the home field for high school teams, 2 of them, for 2 small college teams. And of course, they play the Hall of Fame game here. So you have 3 sets of hash marks. And then you've got other vertical hash marks where the NFL numbers would normally be.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, and you have to have that to play a pro game, those numbers right there.
Gray going right down one set of those hash marks to Gian Robinson for a first down.
But that one where the double ones are outside, that's just where the numbers would be, and they have to put it in there because so many teams run their pass patterns and their defenses based on where the numbers are, the location of the numbers on the field, and here they're in the wrong place, so they have to put those markings in the right place.
Timeout taken by Indy with 21 seconds. Speaking of new stadiums, there's a look at Lucas Oil Stadium, which is right across the parking lot from the RCA Dome and ready to go. This tape was shot on Tuesday, so they're going to open up the stadium in a couple of weeks and have 2 preseason games played in there before we get to town on the 7th night of September for the real opener against the Chicago Bears. from the 47 out, Gray. And that pass is incomplete, intended for Kenton Key. 17 seconds now remaining.
You know, just one more point on the stadium that I had never heard, and I couldn't believe when Tony Dungy told us the other day that it, you know, it has a retractable roof, so you can decide whether you want to be an indoor stadium or an outdoor stadium, and he can make the decision up to 90 minutes before the game. So he can either say, you know, 90 minutes before the game, put the roof on and we'll play an indoor stadium, or don't put the roof on and we'll play an outdoor stadium. I think that is a real competitive advantage. I don't know how, but I think, I mean, there's an advantage there somewhere. I'll figure out how later.
Kenton Keith, the intended recipient, third down. I think a lot of it's going to depend clearly on the weather. I mean, if there are thunderstorms and it's raining and all of that, you close the roof, obviously. Or if it's 18 degrees, I think you close the roof. And otherwise, you know, as Tony said, people want to watch football outside.
Right. And he's thinking that, you know, his choice will be mostly as an outdoor stadium. But they've had a lot of success there as an indoor stadium.
Oh, yeah. Third and 10. And Gray throws deep and short, but it's caught at the six-yard line. However, they do not have a timeout left. Courtney Roby makes the catch, but there is a flag. So that will stop the clock with five ticks as a flag is thrown at the end of the play. And we'll get the call from Walt Coleman.
Quinn Gray has made two big plays the same way by getting in the
pass
pocket and getting
20.
Out.
Defense, that penalty is declined. First down.
So it'll be a first down at the six-yard line, and because of the interference, the Colts are going to be able to get a playoff.
And I mean, this is great. His vision of being able to find, first of all, a hole to run up through and then continue to look upfield and make that throw. Quinn Gray, two big plays tonight in his first half.
Adam Vinatieri will now attempt a field goal of 24 yards as they get the extra play because of the penalty stopping the clock. They were out of timeouts, and Vinatieri's kick is good. As the half expires, and Adam tacks on three more to make it a four-point game with Indianapolis leading Washington 13-9 at halftime of the Hall of Fame game. A live update from Beijing with Bob Costas and Chris Collinsworth right after these messages from your local NBC station.
Appreciation.
And what a great way to begin the third season of NBC's Sunday Night Football. The opener at the Meadowlands on the 4th of September, early 7 o'clock starting time. The Washington Redskins against the New York Giants. Then three nights later to Indianapolis as they open up new Lucas Oil Stadium. Will Peyton Manning be ready is the big question as the Indianapolis Colts host the Chicago Bears. A tremendous slate of Sunday night games in September, including in week 3, the Dallas Cowboys at the Green Bay Packers. That'll really be something. And down the line, Indy, New England, San Diego, New England, and San Diego against Indianapolis. Fred Dean, Darryl Green, and Gary Zimmerman, three more Hall of Famers. We'll be speaking with all of them. We'll get John's take on the Brett Favre situation and take a look at Colt Brennan, who set a lot of records in Hawaii in the second half when we come back to camp.
Both of my parents are deceased. They're the most special of them all, because I'm not here. If they wasn't here first, my dad, Leonard Green, everybody said, you're too little, you can't do it. He said, boy, you can run that ball. They said no. He said go.
Darryl Green, there was no question in the minds of a lot of people who watch football that Darryl would be a first ballot Hall of Famer, and he was. But what happens to you? I mean, even though you don't want to think of yourself as a first ballot Hall of Famer, you are. So what happens to you 5 years after you retire and you get up to that microphone?
It's the most incredible thing John and I were just talking about. It's just you can't plan for it. You've never been there before. It's just spontaneous, and it's just incredible. I think about it now, it's just incredible.
And you'll have that feeling for a long time. I thought thought it was interesting, you know, what you said is they said no. You know, they always said no, you know, you're too small, and your dad said go. And, you know, I mean, how did you apply that your whole life?
And that's a good point, too, because your whole life, they're, even many, many years almost into the NFL, they're still telling you, you can't, are you too little, or you got, you know, you got to match up against this guy, and he's big, and what about this running back? Can you tell? They used to ask me, what are you going to do if you have to face this running back or that running back? When I get there, just like we talked about earlier, when you get to the mic, yeah, I'll just do what I do. And so,
you know, I always thought, you know, every time they say, well, there's a smaller corner and a larger wide receiver, therefore the larger wide receiver will win. Well, that's not true. If the smaller corner is a better player, and that's what you were for 20 years.
You saw that play, matter of fact, this young kid, number 20, I can't remember his last name, but against in that last quarter there. And I was down there with Mr. Snyder. We were talking about this kid against that big wide receiver. And I said, hey, he's big enough. Yeah. He's big enough.
That was Justin Tryon, who was a rookie at Arizona State. You know, a lot of people first heard about you and found out about you on a Monday night in September of 83. There was Tony Dorsett. You'll come into the picture right there. And he's 12 yards away from you at least. Appears to have the angle, but no, sir. And you had Howard Cosell saying, I can't believe the speed of that number 28, Darryl Green.
Very interesting, because that set my life, my career off to a start of saying he's a fast guy. And I tell you, all my life I wanted to be a guy that proved that he could cover.
Well, and the other thing is the want to. I mean, you came all the way across field not playing. There's a lot of guys that would just kind of watch that from afar.
I had 109 tackles that year, chasing guys. Yeah.
But I remember the other thing I used to always say, I could always tell when it was a big game for the Redskins, Darryl Green would be a punt returner.
Yeah, and speaking of big games, the divisional playoffs, January 10th of 1987 against the Chicago Bears, and Joe Gibbs sends you back to return a kick, and away you go.
Boom, right there. That's when I tore my cartilage right there.
Look at that, sure.
That was it. I remember that. Wow, did that hurt, but did that feel good right there?
That hurt so bad.
It hurt so bad. Good. Yes, it did. Well, I'll tell you, that you know, I talked to Joe about that yesterday, about, and he said, well, I made a mistake of not running you punts. I said, no, you didn't. You did it just right.
Every time it was important or a big game, you were back there.
Yeah, that's what our fans knew. If Darryl's back there, this must mean something to Coach Gibbs and the team. So.
Gray sets up a screen after to take a timeout, and that's Mike Hart, the rookie at a Michigan, making the catch. You know, obviously it's a tremendous day for you, and our congratulations to you, Darryl. But what did it mean to you to be able to go in and in your class as your longtime teammate, Art Monk?
That was, oh gosh, that is the most special thing. I mean, not many guys obviously get to do that. I think Montana and Lott did it, maybe some other people in the past. But I mean, we have a very special community, obviously, as you guys could see yesterday. And obviously you guys have been to our city quite a bit, but you know, Art Monk, Darryl Green, hey, we were there for a long time, and great relationship, great friendship, just like going in with my brother.
You were a pleasure to cover. We loved watching you play, Darryl. Thank you so much. Congratulations.
All right, always special.
Bless you. Thank you so much.
Darryl Green of the Washington Redskins going in on the first ballot 5 years after stepping away following a 20-year career with the Skins. Third quarter here, 13-9, Indianapolis. Devin Aroma-Shadu just made the last catch. Quinn Gray is the quarterback, and that pass is incomplete. If it joined us late, Jim Sorgi played the first series, and it was a long series. He's in for 16 plays, and now we see Gray, and before the night is done, the ex-Giant Jared Lorenzen will see some action.
You see that number 78, Mike Pollock? He's a guy, he's a rookie that could end up starting at right guard on this Colt team. I mean, you know, we talk about guys that they like in camp, and this guy is a guy that they really like, and I think they drafted him to be a starter for a long time.
He's out of Arizona State, and that's Mike Hart, who got drafted in the sixth round after a stellar career at Michigan. As we go back for a moment to Pollock. Pollock was a center, but right now he's battling for the starting right guard job with Charlie Johnson.
Right, and I would bet that he'll sometime this season, he'll be a starter. I mean, it takes a while to learn the offense, you know, the pass protections and all the things that they have to do, but I think they drafted him to be their starting right guard.
Hard again. Hart inside the 30 and Hart to the 25-yard line. So Chris Horton makes the tackle. I mean, it's going to be tough for a guy like Hart, who was such a star in college, to make the team, but he's off to a good start with the way he looks tonight. Of course, you've got Joseph Addai, and nobody's going to beat him out. And then they bring in Rose, and he'd have to get by Kenton Keith, who wasn't bad last year as well.
You know, and I'm sure after, you know, talking to Darryl Green and all his life, being told he was too small and he plays 20 years in the NFL and, you know, goes in the Hall of Fame, and I'm not comparing Mike Hart to him, but again, he's the guy that always said, well, he's too small. He's 5'9", he's not big enough, but, you know, he can play pretty big.
Yeah, he loses his helmet, and Hart has reeled off three consecutive carries with gains of 19, 14, and 12.
You see him there? He looks a little like Tony Dorsett facially. But here again, two tight ends, run that stretch play, pull the guard out there, get him in front, and then finish off the run. That's a big thing. I mean, when you can finish off a run, put your shoulder down, keep your feet going, lose your hat, and get two more steps, you have a chance to play in this league.
Hey, let's give Jamie Richards some props. He's the rookie out of Buffalo who snapped the ball out of the end zone on special teams. He's thrown two nice lead blocks on the last two plays, number 61. From the 14-yard line, Gray pump fake, throws to the end zone and incomplete, intended for Pierre Garçon. Talking about Hart playing for the Wolverines, 28 games with 100 or more yards on the ground. In 04, three straight games with 200 or more, and first-team All-Big Ten four seasons ago.
Doesn't he look like a young Tony Dorsett, though?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
A brother. Yep. Second and 10. I was going to say he looks like Tony's son, but, well, he could be Tony's son, too. I mean, Tony is old enough. You keep forgetting that Tony did have a son
right, who
played in the National Football League.
Right, and Tony's here. Tony was in Canton. Yep. He's in the Hall of Fame, and he was here at the dinner the other night anyway.
Holding, 61, offense. 10-yard penalty, still second down.
So Jamie Richards snaps one out of the end zone. We got to give him his props for two nice blocks, and now a hold. He's making his mark tonight.
You know, and the other offensive lineman they like is the guy right next to him there, Steve Justice. He's a center. So, they have a great offensive line coach here in the Colts and Howard Mudd. And, you know, you give him, you know, some young players like they did a year ago, Tony Hugo. You know, he makes some NFL players quickly. And I think these are a couple guys that he's going to be working with and will make the team.
There's a busted play as he was looking at Hart, and Hart is running some other play, and Rob Jackson comes in to get a gift sack flag down.
98 defense lined up in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Take that away now, number 98. There goes the sack. Speaking of Howard Mudd.
Yeah, he's one of the good ones. I mean, he's been an offensive line coach in this league for so long that no matter what a defense does during the game, he's seen. And he knows how to adjust to it. And that's big. You know, I mean, some guys, they say, well, we'll make the adjustment at halftime. Heck, it's too late at halftime. I mean, you have to make adjustments right now on the spot. And most of those adjustments are pass protection adjustments.
Here's Hart again. Turns it back, takes it to the 9. If you called Central Casting and said, send me an offensive line coach for a movie, they would send you Howard Mudd.
Right, and, you know, he keeps getting shorter every year, though. I mean, he...
And look how tough he is. He doesn't have the flap over there. He just has the left ear compressed.
But, you know, he was a guard. He played for the San Francisco 49ers. And he was a player, and he was a good player, and he's been a coach for so long that, like I said, old Howard Mudd, I mean, between Howard Mudd and offensive coordinator Tom Moore on the Colts side, they have seen everything.
Third and 6. And that pass is incomplete. And that'll set up a fourth down and another field goal attempt for the Colts. And this time it will not be Vinatieri, but Adam Crossett, a rookie who they've just signed out of the University of Missouri.
Right. Tony told us last night that he's going to kick the second half. The reason, he just didn't want Vinatieri warming up to have to kick field goals. He said, you know, I want to count his kicks, but He said if he's kicking, he'll be cooking, you know, he'll kick 50 into the net before he goes in there.
28-yard field goal attempt for Crockett, trying to be impressive enough to perhaps win a job someplace else. 10:44 remaining in the third quarter. Three more for the Colts, who lead by seven. Al Michaels and John Madden, Canton, Ohio. You know, I'm looking at the busts in there, and I'm thinking of the ways the word bust can be used in football. I mean, you talk about opposite ends of the spectrum. If you're a high draft choice and you don't make it, you're a bust. But if you're a fabulous player, you get a bust.
And you want the ladder.
Yes,
and once
do.
You get the ladder, you have it forever. You never take it away from you.
Crockett's kick, fielded by Justin Tryon, who takes it up to the 25-yard line. Clinton Portis will not be seeing any action tonight, and not very much, if any, in preseason. But he'll be ready opening night against the Giants. That's in our next life, unfortunately.
I hope.
Yeah. Here's Colt Brennan, now at quarterback. And he starts with a little screen to Marcus Mason. We'll talk a lot about Colt in a moment, but first let's go down to Adam Schefter. Adam?
Thanks, Al. Tony Dungy said Joseph Addai's head injury was fine and he could have come back into the game if they needed him. Also, Tony Dungy said he planned to get a good long look at Mike Hart in the second half. Jim Zorn, meanwhile, plans to run the ball an awful lot in the second half to keep the clock running, and he has a makeshift offensive line and wants to avoid throwing the ball, Al.
And Hart has already carried the ball at him four times for 53 yards. There's a look at Joseph Addai. Just want to keep him healthy for the start of the regular season against Chicago on September the 7th. Brennan hands the ball off again. And we've seen a steady dose of Mason. Colt Brennan, he's 6'3 and 200 pounds. He set a ton of records at the University of Hawaii. But the rap on him was, well, they played at Hawaii. They don't play that tough of a schedule. He's not big enough. He throws sidearm and all of that. In the meantime, he eclipsed just about every mark in the book, and the Redskins decided to take a chance on him and picked him in the sixth round, John.
Yeah, but how'd you like to be Colt Brennan, your quarterback? You get your first opportunity, and your coach says, I just want to run out the clock. I mean, knowing Colt Brennan, he'd like to get back there and throw it every down. Jim Zorn said, I just want to run it to get this game over. And that's what he told Adam Schefter.
Third down and seven. Brennan's going to pass on third and long, and that one is caught. It's a beauty. Pulled in by Billy McMullen. So Colt Brennan to McMullen, aloha.
Boy, that is a heck of a throw. You know, I mean, he doesn't throw it the way a lot of guys throw it, but he put it in the perfect place. Watch Billy McMullen here. He's in the slot, and he just runs right by the defense. I mean, the safety is up there, and, you know, he runs right by him. The deep safety doesn't get over, and Colt Brennan makes a perfect throw. That is a perfect pass. And that's the thing, when you can, you know, get back there, get in the pocket, and have the presence, especially with a young guy, to look deep. You know, they come in there, and a lot of them, they want to, you know, throw that short stuff, that check down. He came in, and he was looking deep all the way.
Now he has to take a timeout. There are the spectacular numbers that Colt Brennan put up at the University of Hawaii in 06 and 07, those 58 touchdown throws. In 06, 38 in 07, and Hawaii wound up going to a bowl championship series game, but they were killed by the University of Georgia in the Sugar Bowl.
I like that touchdown to interception ratio.
Pretty good. Fred Davis makes the catch, the tight end out of USC, one of three second round choices for the Redskins. The Redskins traded down in the draft, but they had three picks in round two and chose two wide receivers and tight end Davis.
Right, one of the things that they felt they needed was bigger receivers. And in those three picks, they did get bigger receivers, Fred Davis at tight end being one of them. But he can also be a slot guy and move around and do some of the things that Chris Cooley does also.
Devin Thomas and Malcolm Kelly are the other wideouts, but they're dinged and not playing tonight. Second rounders. And we'll start with one of the big receivers. Devin Thomas played at Michigan State at 6'2". And then Malcolm Kelly, at Oklahoma. In between, you had the tight end Davis, who's in the game tonight. Kelly is 6 feet four. And both of those guys, the two wideouts, are out of tonight's game with what's listed as hamstring pulls.
They say that Kelly has very, very strong hands. He's a strong wide receiver.
Here's Marcus Mason. I don't like to use the word ding because, you know, everybody uses it when a guy gets hurt. Oh, he's dinged. I mean, you know, ding to you could be, you know, a torn muscle to somebody else. But in preseason, I think you can use the word ding because a lot of guys are very healthy but just aren't playing.
Right. And then if you want to even make it sound better, you know, that the guy's going to be okay next week, you put little in front of him.
Right. A little ding.
What's wrong? Yeah, he has a little ding. That means nothing wrong with him. Right.
Split nail. Second and five. Then Brennan goes down.
It was interesting. Jim Zorn was talking about Colt Brennan, and he said he's not worried about his release and his throw. He's going to leave that alone. He said he's going to work from the bottom up. He said he's going to develop him where he's going to work with his feet and his balance and getting back and doing all those things. Then he said, then I'll work up to his hips and then eventually get to his throwing motion. But, and Troy Aikman used to say this all the time, too, that you're never ready to throw the ball until your feet get in a position to be ready. And that's what Jim Zorn is working with Colt Brennan.
Troy Aikman, Hall of Fame class of 2006. Third and six. Right into the end zone, right there. Into the arms of Maurice Mann for the touchdown.
He can fling it, though.
Yes, he can.
I mean, that's what I mean. He may be a wild flinger, too. He moved a little to get to this, and you see right here is where he's going to throw it, right here and out here to the corner. Makes a good move right there. And Colt Brennan, again, that's a perfect pass. I mean, he threw it right where only his guy was going to get it. Now, I'm not sure if this was a drop back or a rollout, but Jim Zorn was saying that Colt Brennan tends to move the pocket a little more than is called for.
The extra point by Sweezen ties the game. 20-yard pass on a third down and six to Maurice Mann. Colt Brennan, an impressive debut. 16-all. Well, it all begins on Thursday night, September 4th, the Redskins and the Giants in the NFL opener. Then we move to Indianapolis for the Sunday night opener, as the Indianapolis Colts will be hosting the Chicago Bears. Bob and the gang with Football Night in America, preceding every Sunday night game at 7 o'clock Eastern time. Running the trip back to the 30-yard line is Courtney Roby. And Indy starts there. The game is tied at 16-all. Gary Zimmerman goes into the Hall of Fame. We'll hear from Gary when we come back to Kansas.
Ten years ago, after Super Bowl 32, I thought that I had reached the pinnacle of my career by accomplishing a dream that had eluded me for so many years. Making it here today with some of the best who have ever played the game in the gallery, I feel more humbled and blessed than ever before in my life.
Gary Zimmerman, he retired after winning a Super Bowl with Denver. As that pass from Jared Lorenzen is incomplete, intended for Jacob Tenney. Let's meet Gary. Go to Adam.
Thanks, Al. Gary, you were part of an offensive line that didn't speak to the media. What was it like to stand in front of all those people last night and speak to them?
It was tough. I mean, like I said yesterday, the toughest part was being up there alone. And, you know, and that's the thing, is I stood on a lot of guys' shoulders there. And the line position is more than any other position, relying on your buddies. So that was hard for me, but it was also hard to look out there and see all those people and know that they're cheering you on.
According to the Dalai Lama, saying not getting what you want sometimes is a wonderful stroke of luck. How does an offensive lineman come up with the Dalai Lama?
Well, actually, I was working on my speech, and somebody sent an email to my wife that had 25 sayings of the Dalai Lama. And she said, I think this one will work with your speech, because she knew the theme of my speech. So she saw that, and I saw that, and it fit perfectly. So that's what it was.
Now, Gary, what did John Elway say to you back in 1997 to help convince you to come back to the game?
He just said, we got a chance, you know. Well, what happened was, He called. It actually was a lot of. It was my anniversary night, and we talked about it that night. That was the first time my wife and I ever talked about the chance of coming out. And then an hour later, Mike and John called, and they sounded so happy. And it's hard to say no. You know, we just it's got me in the right. The timing was everything on that one.
Thanks, Gary. Congratulations. And now, not many people remember this, but Gary Zerman started his pro football career in the USFL, blocking for another Hall of Fame quarterback, Steve Young.
Absolutely, Adam, with the Los Angeles Express back in 1984. Played at the Coliseum before crowds of about 11,000.
You see Jared Lorenzen on that last play. He had a little burst. In fact, he needed a little burst to get that first down.
6'3 and 285 pounds. Chad Simpson is the ball carrier here. Lorenzen, and you remember him as the backup in New York for Eli Manning. When Lorenzen was born, he came into the world at 13 pounds, 3 ounces. And the happiest person in that hospital that day had to be his mother. 13-3.
And you look at him, and you know, I mean, it's one of those things. You see someone in street clothes, you'd guess, you know, what they do, what they have. You would never, ever guess that this guy's an NFL quarterback.
Second down and 3. You bring back what's my line? And that NFL quarterback's going to get taken down by a defensive back. That's Chris Horton, the rookie out of UCLA, who alertly recovered the surprise onside kick that Indianapolis utilized at the beginning of the game. So a nice night for this kid.
And I think this is a surprise, too, because it's a defensive back blitzing. There hasn't been a lot of blitzing in this game. And, you know, once in a while you bring a linebacker. But here, when you bring a safety from the outside, the Colts pass protection, or this group of pass protectors, wasn't ready for it.
249th guy picked in the draft out of UCLA. Third down and 13. Lorenzen winds up and throws a bullet downfield, and that's incomplete. Try to get it into Jacob Tammy, the rookie tight end out of the University of Kentucky, and it's fourth down.
Yeah, that was just a bad throw. He was just hoping something would happen. He was throwing it. One thing you never do is you never throw in the middle of the field into a crowd, and he threw in the middle of the field into a crowd. I mean, there's nothing. In fact, Tom Moore's just telling him that right now. You never do that. We have other things in this offense, other places to go.
Hunter's booming kick into the northeastern Ohio night sky. Maurice Mann will run it back up to the 12-yard line. Well, tonight at Lambeau Field in Green Bay, it's family night. They have a scrimmage, and here are some, well, highlights, lowlights, whatever you want to call them. That's Aaron Rodgers in the red jersey, which means don't hit him. And, of course, with Favre now arriving in Green Bay, we saw Rodgers throw a pretty good pass there and a couple of not-so-very good passes coming up right here. And, of course, it's still to be determined, John. I mean, the story is not over. The latest, of course, is that Brett has been reinstated. Take a physical tomorrow. That's a formality. Wind up practicing with the Packers, supposedly in the early afternoon. This is our first down here. It is Brennan handing it off to Marcus Mason. But, John, I think the story is a long way from over. He'll be reactivated or activated tomorrow. The word is he'll compete for the starting quarterback position. But I talked to a high-level NFL GM tonight, and I said, what do you think of the odds of Favre actually starting the season with Green Bay? And he said 8-1 again. So, I don't know. That's one man's opinion. What do you think?
Where did he think he was going to be, in Minnesota?
Well, he didn't say, but he just thought it was 8-1 against.
I would think if it's really open competition, I think he starts for the Green Bay Packers. And that's the way it should be. It should be an open competition. I mean, I read somewhere where, you know, they want him to come in as a backup. That's a bunch of baloney. You don't play
holding
football.
61. Defense. 5-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
I mean, you earn the right to start. So, you know, let them both play or whatever they want to do, and then whoever earns the right to start, starts. And that's what I think will happen. I mean, I don't know, you know, that. But to me, you know, if you have a chance to get him back and he wants to come back, I would take him and I'd take him and play him is what I would do.
And then, well, you still are going to be in that situation again at the end of this year as Brennan swings it to the outside and the pass is incomplete. And I mean, don't you feel that a lot of this happened in the first place, because this was like the fourth time in a row that Brett got to the point where the team finally said, hey, look, you got to tell us what you want to do.
Right, and but you know, we don't always know what we want to do at a certain time of the year. I mean, that's you know, I mean, so many NFL players and coaches go through that. I mean, they go through the same thing. You know, at the end, I mean, they're tired, they're beat up, they've had enough, I'm not going to do it anymore. And then, you know, around April, May, June, you start to feel pretty good. Hey, I'm ready to go again, I think. And that happens more than you think.
Second and 10, Brennan, and that is a bullseye. A 26-yard completion to Jason Good, rookie free agent out of Maryland. And Colt Brennan has been on the money.
You know, the thing that I just said to Lorenzen can't do, I think Colt Brennan just did. Yeah, I mean, there's always been a rule for a quarterback. I mean, he goes play pass that you never throw the ball in the middle if there's a free safety sitting there. He did it. But if you can throw it in that little hole, I mean, there's a short window right there, and he got it in there. And you see how he threw it sidearm? Mm-hmm. I mean, he had to find that hole up front to throw the ball through the lineman to get it to that point.
Minute and a half to go in the period. Rock Cartwright is there for no gain. Well, Rich Gannon had a pretty good career at a throwing the ball sidearm.
And, you know, and we always talk about, you know, you shouldn't throw a sidearm, but a lot of times you have to throw. I mean, to be able to make all the throws from all the angles and the movements and guys rushing, all those things that happen to you, you have to be able to throw at different angles. In fact, Jim Zorn has a drill where he has the quarterbacks drop back, and then he throws bags at them, you know, so that they don't pay attention to, you know, stuff that's happening around them. They just concentrate downfield.
On second down and 11, there's a screen pass. Cartwright. And locks it down at the 41-yard line in the final minute of the third quarter. Game tied at 16. Here's a look at the drill that you're talking about here. It's something that he did in Seattle as well, throwing bags at the quarterback.
Yeah, right. And, you know, because you can't hit him, but there's always something in a pocket. You know, I mean, there's always going to be guys grabbing guys around your feet, stepping up. Gamble got one right in the face at that. But it makes you, you know, concentrate and focus downfield and not be looking down, because you cannot. If you ever take your eyes off downfield or off looking upfield, you don't have a chance.
Third and 2. And that pass is behind the intended receiver, Billy McMullen. And we have a flag down at the 44-yard line.
I think it's against the Colts. We haven't seen this
offside,
bunch a lot.
95. Defense lined up in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
It's Darrell Reed, who was a special teams maven last year and will be again this season for Indy.
You know what the Redskins just did? I mean, it's a thing that Seattle did a lot of, too. They go bunch or triple right and then isolate you out there on the weak side or backside and throw the slant to that side. That's a staple in this offense.
First down for the Redskins at the Colt 36-yard line. Maurice Mann, who caught a touchdown pass earlier to tie the game. A little shy of the first as we come to the end of the third quarter. Indianapolis 16, Washington 16. NBC's Sunday Night Football from Canton, Ohio continues after these messages from your local NBC station. All right. MetLife providing these shots from above. Visit MetLife.com to learn more about the MetLife blimp. Guaranteed for the ifs in life, MetLife. To the fourth quarter we go. Canton, Ohio. Al Michaels, John Madden, and Adam Schefter filling in for Andrea Kramer, who's getting ready to cover the Olympics, which start Friday on NBC. And here's Rock Cartwright on second and 2. Picking up one. The Redskins quarterbacks tonight have been right on the money, all three of them. When you look at these numbers, only two incompletions tonight. Campbell was 5 of 5. Collins was 5 of 6. And Brennan, 7 out of 8 with a touchdown.
So far, Jim Zorn has pretty good grades because, as we know, he's not only the head coach, but he's also the offensive coordinator, and he's also the quarterbacks coach. And I mean, these are the guys that he's been working with, and These are the types of things that he wants to see.
Here's Cartwright. And Cartwright is able to escape a couple of tackles in the backfield and perhaps pick up enough for a first down.
You know, but we have to remember, again, this is a bonus first preseason game, and you know, you don't go jumping up, you know, and having a parade for these guys. But, you know, they are on the right track. And this is a good game. I mean, you know, there's been very few penalties. It's been, you know, pretty crisp. There's been very few, if any, injuries. I mean, there's been no injuries. And, I mean, this is a way.
Yeah, you put the kibosh on that one.
And now we have an injury. But this is the way the game should be played.
It's Todd Wade back in a minute.
You know, when you get used to it, you get used to getting down in the dirt, getting your clothes dirty and walling a little bit. It makes everything come out right when you can stand up out of the mud or the sod and feel comfortable. So I said to myself, I like the dirt. And if I can beat somebody in this dirt, it's going to be a good thing.
Fred Dean spending his career the first part in San Diego and then on to San Francisco under Bill Walsh and two Super Bowl championships. Adam will speak with him in a minute as we come back on a first and 10, and the pass over the middle for a gain of 6 to Fred Davis, and let's go down to Adam.
Thanks very much, Al. A great moment last night, Fred. You lost your glasses. Len Barney came over, gave you his. When did you realize that your glasses were missing and you wouldn't have them to read your speech?
Well, when I reached up to get my glasses out of my coat pocket, I found that it wasn't the same coat that I had on. I had sent my coat to my wife, and my glasses was in it, so that's what I found that I lost them.
Now, you mentioned that you practiced not crying. How much crying did you do while rehearsing for your speech?
Well, I did quite a bit of crying, you know, crying about mom and, you know, and all of those things. It's like I about cried out for everything, you know. So it's like that's what it boiled down to.
Fred, what did your impact as a situational pass rusher do for the game today?
Well, I think it what Coach Bill Washington Stutley did for me as far as the pass rushing put me on an island, sort of, and made me, I was able to go from all angles and do many things. So it's like it opened up an avenue. It caused a lot of the Charles Haley's and all of those guys today to do the same type of play.
Congratulations, Fred. And now Fred Dean is the second Hall of Famer to come from Louisiana Tech. The first, Terry Bradshaw.
Yeah, that's a pretty good pair to draw to, isn't it? Terry Bradshaw with four rings and Fred Dean with a pair.
I remember we did the first game that he came to the 49ers from the San Diego Chargers against the Dallas Cowboys, and he sacked Danny White like three or four times, and no one knew who he was. And Bill Walsh knew that he had just got something special in Fred Dean.
And then he got Pat Hayden. I think he got him five times a couple of weeks after that. I mean,
Fred Dean could really mess with a tackle.
Marcus Mason out of Youngstown State. Fred Dean, Chargers for seven seasons and then 5 years with the San Francisco 49ers in action here against the Kansas City Chiefs and here against Tampa Bay, just busting through from the right side of the line, planting the quarterback.
Every great outside pass rusher has to have an inside move. You can't be a great outside pass rusher. Fred Dean had that. He talked about Charles Haley had that. Deacon Jones had that. All the great ones had that.
Marcus Mason has seen a ton of action tonight. 15 carries, 64 yards. Fun for him because he played his college ball down the road at Youngstown State. The big writing is the stuff that he's added, has Zorn, during the game.
Well, he said he learned that from Mike Holmgren. He always had his game plan, and that would be the typed part. And then he'd have lists of things that he wanted to do, special things written in groups.
This is the 15th play of the drive. And Brennan improvising and hitting Mason for a touchdown. Jason Taylor saluting that one. Colt Brennan has led two touchdown drives. Stephon Heyer, the left tackle, is shaken up, so there'll be a moment before the extra point, but this is quite an impressive preseason debut for Colt Brennan.
I like the way he plays. I mean, you just feel, I mean, we're standing up here away from, but you can just feel his energy. I mean, he brings a certain energy to the game, a certain energy to that team, and we talk about throwing, you know, and not throwing always the way you're supposed to, but throwing from every angle. I mean, the veterans, they have their pads off, the other guys, they like this too. I mean, Colt Brennan is a player's type of guy. You know, I mean, all players are going to love him the way he plays.
Stephon Heyer, the starting left tackle. A lot of that exultation on the Redskin bench was muted as they looked at Heyer, who was down and attended by three guys from the training staff. But he gets up and walks away. And Colt Brennan. I mean, is there a better name for a quarterback than Colt Brennan?
No, that's what you'd want to be. You know, and you know, Colt Brennan, and if he was from like Butte, Montana, that would be the perfect name and place to be from.
And smoking a Marlboro. 23-16 Washington. The display of helmets right next door at the Pro Football Hall of Fame here in Canton, Ohio. Washington leading by 7. Kick fielded by Courtney Roby at the 4-yard line, and he brings it back up to the 19-yard line. Well, what's going on at Lambeau Field? We know that the Favs arrived in town, and there is Deanna in the Favs suite. It's family night. There's a scrimmage going on, and we have very good information that Brett is also at the stadium. I don't know where he is in the stadium. I can't imagine he's made his presence known there. But there is Deanna in the suite. There's a scrimmage going on, or there was a little bit earlier. And away we go in Green Bay for another week of wildness. Here's Lorenzen taking the inside draw out of the shotgun, hitting Pierre Garçon. How about Tony Dungy? You know, time flies and we know it. And Tony was at Tampa Bay for 6 years. He is now in his 7th season. So he's been at Indianapolis now longer than he was at Tampa Bay. Tony has led his team to the playoffs in each of his years in Indianapolis and 3 more in Tampa Bay. 9 consecutive playoff appearances for a man now in his 13th season. And the pass is caught, but a little shy of the first down, it appears, by Garçon. Talked about him and that beatific look of Tony. I mean, he's always unflappable and looks the same whether they're up by 30 or down by 30. And, you know, I look at Tony Dungy, John, and I think the name of the book that he wrote that was a number one bestseller on the New York Times bestseller list for a while and stayed on that list for a long time is the perfect summation of Tony Dungy, Quiet Strength.
Right, and that's exactly what he is. And, you know, he exudes that as a head coach and as a man. And, you know, and that's the way his team acts and reacts.
Lorenzen pump fakes and goes back to the same man, that's Roy Hall. When last season ended, you recall, there was a lot of speculation. In fact, there were some reports that Tony was ready to retire because he's talked about it, and it's not going to be something that he's going to go on and on and on and do. He has other things he'd like to do in his life, but he said, as usual, he said, I just needed some time at the end of the season, assess, look at the big picture, and then I decided to come back. And in the interim, they decided that Jim Caldwell, who's on the staff as the assistant head coach, will eventually, and there is Jim, will eventually succeed Tony Dungy, whether it's next year or 2 years or 3 years down the line, to be determined. And that pass is knocked down at the line of scrimmage.
Right, and Tony said that he felt more comfortable that way because everyone knows, you know, that the system is in place. Jim Caldwell will be the head coach. So he doesn't have to make that decision quickly. He doesn't have to say, okay, I got to do it quickly so they can get a new guy in here so he can get ready for the draft. And Caldwell is going to be the guy, and then Tony can just take his time. And You know, and he said, I don't want to happen what happened to Brett Favre. He said, you know, that where you decide that you don't want to play anymore, you don't want to coach anymore, and then a month later you decide that you do. So he said he's going to take his time, and when that time comes, he's just going to leave.
Low snap fielded by Lorenzo on third and four, and that pass is incomplete. The coverage was good. The rush was on. Roy Holler was the intended receiver, and he was smacked by Justin Tryon, the rookie from Arizona State. So Caldwell, the one-time coach at Wake Forest, and one of the reasons Tony said I had a, you know, we had to put this in place is that Caldwell was interviewed last offseason by Baltimore and Atlanta, and had been interviewed in past years by Dallas, Arizona, Buffalo, and Minnesota. So he was a guy who was going to be in demand and would eventually have wound up with a job if Tony didn't put this in place.
Right, and Tony is a real student of the game and history, and he knows what happened to Bill Walsh. I mean, Bill Walsh always regretted the fact that he retired too soon from the 49ers. Joe Gibbs retired and came back, thought that he did it too soon.
Man fumbled or muffed the punt, but is able to fall back on it with 7:58 to go. Skins by a touchdown. Log on to NBCSports.com and you can read Tom Curran's NFL training camp preview and NFL.com. For all you fantasy fans, you can sign up right there at NFL.com. 23-16 Washington. 7:58 to go in the fourth quarter, and Derek Devine becomes Washington's fourth quarterback. Played his college ball at Marshall. And here's Marcus Mason carrying the ball for the 16th time tonight. Let's go to Adam Schefter.
Thanks very much, Al. We're here with Jason Taylor. And, Jason, you spent your entire career with the Miami Dolphins. What has it been like spending the last 2 weeks in Washington with the Redskins?
It's been a lot different. You know, the transition is tough, and particularly the way it happened because it was so sudden. And had to pack one bag and move to D.C. So I'm still trying to get settled in. My family's in Miami, and that's the toughest part.
What has been the biggest adjustment aside from having your family in Miami?
Everything, really. I mean, it's a new defense, a new building, it's new teammates, new colors. I had to put the new colors on the night. It was different. You know, it seemed weird. And I think the guys realized that I was kind of uneasy about it at first. But it's some getting used to.
Tougher getting ready for Dancing with the Stars or going through training camp?
Dancing with the Stars is tougher. Yeah, because, I mean, training camp is difficult. But it's football. I know what I'm doing. Dancing with the Stars, I had no clue. So I had to learn something new every day, and it was difficult.
Dancing with the Stars, tougher than training camp. Amazing. Now, Al and John have been talking about your wristbands. Can you hold it up and tell us what the meaning of your wristbands actually are?
Well, I write "Truly Blessed" on my wrist tape, and then on this side. And this side is my wife's initials and all of my kids' initials. So it's I'm very truly blessed to play this game, and we all are. To do it for 12 years now is way more than I ever thought it would be. And all the things the game has afforded me has been awesome. And then my number one thing in life is your family, so I keep them close.
Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you about Miami, Bill Parcells. A lot was made of the relationship between the two of you. What was the real story there?
A lot more was made of it than should have been. And we all see how stories can take on their own life and kind of be out of control, as we're witnessing with Brett Favre's deal now. So it's, you know, was he happy I danced? No, I'm sure. But, you know, it is what it is. And I think it was a good decision for myself and my family. And here I am in Washington now, so what are you going to say?
What do you think of the way the Brett Favre situation has turned out, Jason?
It's the same for everybody, you know. It's for someone that's a legend like he is, one of the greatest to ever play our sport. And he's in a tough position now. They don't want him, and he wants to play ball. So what's he supposed to do?
He's back in camp, isn't he?
Well, there you go.
Al and Jason Taylor already has become a player favorite in Washington. He's given over 100 pairs of shoes to the rest of his teammates.
Word travels quickly. I'm trying to bribe him into liking me.
Oh, they're going to like him. They're going to love him when they get to see him in action. Of course, a stellar career at Miami, and you put him with Andre Carter on opposite sides of that defensive line, and they'll wreak some havoc.
Right, and you know, he's one of those guys that has a great motor, as they say, and you know plays one way all the time, plays very hard, and he's a nightmare for offensive tackles.
Now Devine swings it to the outside, and the pass is incomplete. After we saw while Adam was interviewing Jason, Marcus Mason carried the ball a few more times, and Mason tonight, he's done the bulk of the ball carrying, 19 carries for a kid who was on a practice squad last year with the Redskins and kind of grew up in the D.C. area, went to prep school in Maryland, and as we mentioned a couple of times tonight, played his college ball down the road at Youngstown.
Well, Jim Zorn said that he was going to just run a lot, run the clock off and get some time off when he put Colt Brennan in there. And then Brennan went 9 for 10, 123 yards, and two touchdowns. So much for just running it. Now with Derek Devine, that's probably what he's also going to do.
Now he gives it to Cartwright, and Rock carries the ball for the 12th time. So Mason and Cartwright now 31 carries between them. Take a look at Brennan on the night. Big night for Colt, 9 out of 10, two touchdowns. The only incomplete pass was a slant that he threw a little bit behind the receiver, and the rating is almost perfect.
And I think Jim Zorn, you know, probably decided, you know, I want to get this game over with. I want to run more, you know, take time off the clock. But I also want Colt Brennan to play. And now with Derek Devine, this is probably what he was thinking when he told Adam that he was going to do that earlier. And then sometimes you get a quarterback, you know, an old quarterback, they just can't help themselves. What do you mean, run? That's enough of that run. Let's throw the ball.
Durant Brooks played his college football at Georgia Tech, drafted in the sixth round. He won the Ray Guy Award, given to the top college punter. Derek Frost is their incumbent punter, but when you draft a guy, you got a chance to make the team, obviously. Hope he does. One hopper fielded at the 15-yard line by Pierre Garçon. And look at the uniforms of some of the brand new Hall of Famers on this night in Canton. All of the rookies in the NFL visited the Hall of Fame this summer. It was an idea presented by Michael Irvin, actually, to the commissioner. Chris Long, standing next to the bust of his father, Howie. Jake Long, the number one overall pick. The Dolphins, Matt Ryan, who goes to Atlanta as their hope for the future at quarterback. Darren McFadden, the running back from Arkansas, now playing with the Raiders. And they brought all the rookies in just to go around the Hall of Fame and get a sense of, you know, what the history of the sport is about. And frankly, it's a terrific idea because, as we all know, in sports these days, guys sometimes have no clue as to what happened as recently as 15 or 20 years ago.
No, I don't know, and I think that's a great idea. That, you know, and I think, you know, all players ought to see it. All coaches ought to see it. And I always say, if you're a fan of pro football and you have an opportunity, even if you don't have an opportunity, you ought to make an opportunity to come here. I mean, this is a shrine to pro football, and if you're a fan of it, sometime in your life, you have to go through this.
Second and 12, and Lorenzen airs one out, and that is incomplete. And for Courtney Roby, that's an easy trip for a lot of folks in the East and the Midwest.
Well, I was thinking of that. You know, it's not like, you know, it's in another country or something. Look, it's 6 hours from Chicago, 5 hours from Indianapolis, 3 hours from Detroit, 2 hours from Pittsburgh, 7 hours from New York, six from Washington, 12 from Kansas. So I mean, there's a lot of people in that area that are a short ride from here that ought to get here and see it and feel it and experience it, because it is very, very special.
Third and 12. And that pass is caught, but well shy of the first. You know, I just thought of something. You're not that far from Cleveland, so you want to make a whole trip out of, you know, coming to Northeast Ohio. You go to the Hall of Fame, and then you go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Right.
That's
now you're talking Hall of Fame.
That's a good trip.
I mean, you get a double dip, and right, you know, within an hour.
Yep.
We had to go to Cleveland last night because both the Redskins and the Colts, both teams stayed in Cleveland. And there's something wrong with that. I mean, I think that, you know, somewhere we have to work where we get the teams to stay here in Canton.
Well, fourth and six, and deep in their own territory, they're going to go for it and make it. So Jacob Tammy makes the catch up at the 29-yard line. And this is one of those things, in the regular season, what would you do? Well, you'd probably punt, assuming you had all of your timeouts left plus a two-minute warning. But it's preseason, and Dungy lets them go for it, and they cash in.
Well, this is a way you can take the, you know, the third quarterback that you play in a game and Jared Lorenzen, and give him a play where you have it down. You have to make a play. You want You want to get your players in games in situations like this.
And that pass is incomplete. So this is Courtney Rowley. 216. Well-played game. John and I talking about very few penalties. Fortunately, very few injuries. And that's good because these days, I got to tell you, in the NFL, it might be easier to log on to Amnesty International from downtown Beijing than it is to get a 100% accurate injury report. There's a lot of subterfuge going on these days.
Well, there is. And then, you know, because of the salary cap and there's only 80 players and it's hard to practice, and then teams start getting worried about getting injured and they start playing scared. And I don't know. I mean, it just kind of goes awry.
On second and 10, that pass is caught. It's called in by Roy Hall before he steps out of bounds to stop the clock with 2:08 left in the fourth.
You know, we're talking about those rookies coming here to Canton, and I talked to one of the PR guys on one of the teams, and he said, who do you think the most popular player was in the Hall of Fame that they wanted to see? And, you know, I guess this guy, that guy, that guy. Anyway, the answer was Barry Sanders. And when you think about it, it makes sense. I mean, these guys are, you know, 21, 22. So when they were kids, everyone starts off as a running back. I mean, you don't start off as a lineman. You grow into being a lineman.
And Lorenzen gets blindsided and sacked from behind. And that's Chris Horton. So another big play for Horton, a seventh-round pick. That's the last round of the draft. Two sacks for Horton, both on blitzes. And remember, at the beginning of the game, that surprise onside kick by Indianapolis recovered by Horton.
See, Horton comes from this side. They're not counting him. They didn't even look at him. They're not ready for that protection.
Two-minute warning. We're back in Canton, Ohio. Al Michaels, John Madden, Adam Schefter joining us tonight in lieu of Andrew Kramer over in Beijing. And a great job done by Adam and Patrick McManus filling in for our regular director, Drew Esikoff, over in Beijing. Great job, Patrick. Fred Godelli heading our crew. It's fourth down and 7 from the 31-yard line. And Lorenzen trying to convert again. It's intercepted. This time it's picked off by Matterral Richardson, who goes all the way in for a touchdown. Richardson, a rookie out of Arkansas. Matterral Richardson, a 38-yard interception run back to just about salt it for the Washington Redskins.
Well, you know, there's been very little blitzing in this game, and the Redskins came on a safety blitz. Lorenzen had to get rid of the ball. You see, he has man-to-man coverage there, and he just gets a jump on it. He throws it a little late, and he has to bring his receiver back. He let him in a little too much, got the jump and got the interception. But again, he had to get rid of it because he was getting pressure because of the safety blitz.
And the extra point by Sean Sweezum makes it a two-touchdown game with a minute and 50. And the sagacious Tom Moore going over the last play with Lorenzen. Hail to the Redskins is the song being played right now at Fawcett Stadium.
Well, you know, Canton, Ohio was full of Redskins fans this weekend. Of course, Daryl Green, Art Monk going into the Hall of Fame, and the Redskins playing in the game, and we just showed on the map that it's not really that far.
Fight for old DC.
Well, you know that brings back some great memories. I hear some of the, you know, when we talked about Daryl Green and Art Monk, and then you just remember those guys and John Riggins and those songs, and then these guys today. Look at Sean Spring. I mean, they're excited. I mean, I think Jim Zorn has brought a little of that to the team. You know, some youthful, you know, some new stuff, some new, you know, confidence, some new things that, you know, make them feel pretty good about themselves. But as we said earlier, you can't start feeling too good about yourself in this game.
A long way from Canton, Ohio, to Tampa, Florida, which is the site of this year's Super Bowl.
And we're not going to keep any of these players here because of the way they played tonight. They will not be anointed.
Pierre Garçon.
Uh-oh.
And Garçon with a good run back Up to the 48-yard line he goes, and 1:41 to go in the fourth. Sunday Night Football being brought to you by Verizon Wireless and by Lincoln Financial Group. Get to know your future self at LincolnFinancial.com. Well, Jim Zorn getting the job, and we talked about the chronology and how crazy it was. I mean, you get hired. I mean, first of all, when the owner and your football operations chief, Vinny Serrato, hire the coordinators before the head coach, that's unusual to begin with. As the catch is made by Jones, and then Zorn gets the job, and Greg Blosch, the defensive coordinator, who had worked behind Greg Williams last year, he was going to retire. And Snyder talked him into staying, and he's the D.C. on the staff right now. Second and three as Lorenzen throws and keeps the chains moving, and you got a flag down here, and that's going to stop the clock with a minute and 15 seconds. A momentary first down as the ball goes to the 31-yard line. There is Greg Blosch.
Yeah, and the Redskins are really trying to win this game. I mean, there's been a couple
illegal
of big
shift.
Plays.
Two men moving and not resetting. Offense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
A couple of big defensive plays where they came on blitzes and brought safeties, and again, the Colts and their pass protections were not ready for it.
Second and eight. Jim Fossil is working the radio broadcast tonight. Talked to Jim before the game, and it looked like Jim was going to get the job. In fact, Jim thought he was going to get the Redskin job after they let Steve Spurrier go and before Joe Gibbs came in 4 years ago.
So it happened to him twice.
Yeah. And then Chad Simpson takes it to the 41. So Fossil gets interviewed by Snyder and Serrato, and some people thought that he was going to get the job. And one of the things that Fossil said to Snyder and Serrato was that Jim Zorn would be the kind of guy he'd like to have as his offensive coordinator.
Right, and that he would keep Greg Blosch as the defensive coordinator.
Right. He should get a broker's fee.
Right. Lorenzen is getting a little no huddle here. They, you know, they didn't think he would get any no huddle in this game anyway.
And Lorenzen moves to his right and watching, giving him all he wants underneath as Mike Hart makes the catch at the 25. And now Indianapolis is going to have to use a timeout. They have only one remaining, and they're down by two touchdowns. You know, you're talking about coaching staffs and the changeover and the big change in Washington. The Blosch is still there. Bugle is still there, but one of the things that would be at the foundation of the Indianapolis success, of course, is the fact that, you know, Jimmy Irsay has owned the team for a number of years. Bill Polian's been there. Dungy's now in his seventh season. Tom Moore has been there forever. Ron Meeks, Jim Caldwell, Howard Mudd. I mean, that is some staff.
Yeah, and, you know, the thing I remember Tom Moore saying a couple years ago, and it made so much sense, that no matter what happens during a game, we've seen it before, and we know how to fix it. And that's what coaches have to do in the sidelines and in today's football, is fix things that go wrong.
And Lorenzen goes for the end zone, and that's incomplete. And what went wrong is that Courtney Rowley couldn't hold on to the ball for 6 points. Second and 10.
Yeah, this is a good throw. I mean, they got pretty good protection, and as you said, Roby just drops that ball. And right through his hands and hit him in the face mask. No, you don't do that. I mean, that's one thing, you know, a quarterback can't do. And when you're new with a team, you don't want to do that old woe is me type of thing. Just get in the huddle and call a play and do it.
And this time it's a juggling catch. It's made by Hall, but we're down to 14 and ticking down, and Indianapolis will spend its last timeout. Timeout, Colts. John, the horse trailer, you and I got this thing started 6 years ago. So the seventh season of the horse trailer. And I can't believe I was out in the compound earlier and I said, what is that? I mean, it used to be this little dingy, you know, like $48 toy. And the next thing you know, we've got $1 million rig. How did that happen?
I don't know. I didn't know that. That's the first time I've seen it. But it did start out as a real horse trailer. You would go and do voiceover in a real horse trailer.
In the horse trailer. So now we had a horse trailer player of the game. And so we've gone from this his little piece of garbage tooling down the highway to a luxury van. As Lorenzen throws that one, and it's going to go out of the end zone. Down to 9-7.
And that was 6 years ago, but we don't have a horse player, a horse trailer player of the game in the preseason.
Not in preseason. Right? No, we can't afford one.
Say we did.
If we did tonight?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what. Colt Brennan would be one of the choices. You know, Mason's carried the ball 19 times for 98 yards.
I've been impressed with the Redskin run game. I mean, they just ran right at it. How about Jason Campbell?
The way he played. Yeah. Chris Horton, there was a defensive player of the game, defense and special teams. Second and 10. We're in horse trailer training camp right now, John. It's Mike Hart. And Hart will be taken down at the 2-yard line, and that will be the end of the game. But we've been covering this game for a lot of years. That's about as efficiently and well played a Hall of Fame game as I've seen.
Right, and I think you have to give, you know, tribute to the coaches for that. I mean, to be able to get these teams ready to play this type of game, I think they both did a very good job.
Well, Jim Zorn, at the age of 55, gets his first head coaching opportunity, and that smile said it all. What a night for Jim and the Redskins. Our next preseason special, Jaguars against the Redskins, August 28th. Coming up next on the West Coast, the late local news, and starting at midnight Eastern, it's Dateline, all next on NBC. And this, of course, the week of the Olympics. Al Michaels, John Madden, Adam Schechter, our entire NBC sports crew, saying goodnight from Canton, Ohio.
NBC Sports, home of Super Bowl 43. Thanks you for watching this presentation of the National Football League.